Welcome back to segment four today, as we talk about defining and perceiving disabilities. Thus far, we've talked about models of disability as one of them being the moral model. Well, this segment will focus on what's considered to be the medical model. And it's probably the most prevalent, particularly in Western society, that when we think of disability, we think of it more as a medical problem or a medical issue. As we think of the medical model, there's certainly been tremendous strides made to keep people alive so that we have more people now with disabilities than ever before. Improved diagnosis has been incredibly helpful from the standpoint of little children who would have left the hospital years ago and not have conditions recognized or diagnosed. Now those are being diagnosed. Hearing loss is a prime example. There's newborn hearing screening such that a child who is in the hospital before being released, in most cases at this point, undergoes newborn hearing screening so we can tell if that child has a likelihood of having a hearing loss. From an intervention standpoint, that's huge because that allows those children who have hearing losses to get intervention much earlier than they would have otherwise. So there are lots of very strong, very positive things about the medical model, and so I don't mean at all to be disparaging of it. It does, however, have some issues that do make it difficult for people with disabilities and or families. One of them has to do with the idea that we're very high-tech, but shall we say low-touch, that we rely a lot on technology, but from a training standpoint, from a practitioner standpoint, don't spend nearly as much time as we might creating practitioners in all the various health fields who are more empathic, who are better listeners, who really work collaboratively with patients. Within this model, too, there's a sense that, you know, if I am the doctor, or in my background when I was a psychologist, you know, you're the expert, and so you know what's best, so you're telling the person, this is what you need to do. There's kind of an expectation that the patient or the individual will be passive. And, you know, I suspect many of you, as you think of your experiences, recognize that you've gone to a doctor's office or gone to some place and you basically listen to what he or she tells you to do, but you don't really engage them in a shared conversation. One of the underlying features, if you will, one of the premises of the medical model, too, is the idea that the goal is really to fix the disability, to cure the person. So the goal is on fixing or curing or helping them return to as close to, quote, normal as possible. And that's something that, while certainly admirable in many respects, isn't achievable for many. And so then there's a disconnect between, well, this is what our goal is. If you can't get to there, then we don't really have much for you. So it tends to be more of, as I'm going to talk about here, an individual's problem, not a societal problem. Another aspect that I would like to mention about this and is the idea that within the medical model, we really don't look at disability as a societal problem. It's really seen as the individual's problem, so that if you have a disability, if you, for example, now use a wheelchair as an example, and there is a particular restaurant or bar that you used to go to frequently, but it doesn't have an accessible entrance, from medical model thinking, the idea would be, well, adjust your lifestyle. Go to a different bar, go to a different place, because if you can't get in there, that's your problem. So there's this broader sense that disability is an individual issue rather than a group issue. Again, as we've talked about these models, you heard when we were talking about the moral model from speakers on their perspective, their interaction with how people look at them. Would also now like to give you a couple of speakers' perspectives on how they are perceived, you know, within the medical model, how they see themselves and how others have interacted with them.
If
if
society imposes a medical model, I would just tell them, ignore them, because if you really feel perfectly fine where you are, then you are fine.
Honestly, as far as all that stuff goes, what I can say that's the most important that will then solve all the etiquette questions and all those other things is just listen to a person. And when a person who has a disability talks to you about it, I have had reactions in public when someone would ask me questions about it, like, what's it like to be blind? And you say, you know what, it's not really that bad. They go, oh, it's so great that you think like that. And you can tell that they don't believe you, that you're obviously not interacting with the world in a complete way. And there may even be some who are watching this that are feeling that. But listen to what that person tells you, because ultimately, I am the blindness expert. There are many sighted professionals in the blindness field who have dedicated years and years to this, but blind people will still come to me over them 9 times out of 10, because not only do I have the academic prowess that I gained here, but I have the real life experience as somebody who has it and who has done it and will continue to do it.
All right, so as we end this session, I want to talk and summarize the idea of, so what is the medical model? Because there are lots of benefits to it, that we certainly have seen better outcomes, better treatment, better diagnosis. The idea that certainly if you had an infection and it was before the development of antibiotics, you would have died, now is no big deal. We have lots of really helpful things that have arisen as a result of the medical model. On the other hand, as we think about it as related to disability, you know, there are some liabilities that we addressed. One of them being that while we have a lot of technology, it doesn't necessarily translate to, and do we also have the human touch? We have an expectation in this model of the healthcare provider as expert. And so if I'm the expert, I'm not necessarily looking for collaboration. So there's a long-term kind of a tendency to look at the individual as sick, as passive, and as not as a collaborator, which certainly, as we talk about people with disabilities and empowerment and inclusion, is something that should certainly be happening. And then the final thing that we had said in this topic of the medical model is that, again, the focus, much like in the moral model, is on the individual. It's not on the broader society. And it's that idea of the individual and with a disability and his or her relationship to the broader society that will form the basis of our next segment when we go and talk about the social model of disability.